exposed to oil and gas, and since the area which we are in, the Gulf, is actually because of oil. So the basic three stages of any oil and gas process chain is upstream, midstream and downstream. If you see, the oil extraction comes in upstream, the refining stage is called as the midstream, and the retail petrol pumps that we see comes in the downstream. So basically, I was working for upstream companies. There are three main what we can say players in the oil industry. One, as you can see, the national oil companies, which own the oil, reserves. Saudi Aramco is the biggest one. That day we had stopped at the ADNOC petrol pump. So these are the these companies own the 80% oil reserves. Then are the international oil companies, as we see, Shell, ExxonMobil, Chevron, BP, and Total. If you want to see, if you go through the financial muscle of these companies, these five companies have a combined revenues more than the India's GDP. So they have got a mighty wealth with them. So these are the oil companies which own the oil process. And finally, there are some, as we learned that today, there are turnkey players who actually make the construction and give it to the oil companies. So these are the leading oil companies. These are called as EPCC players who do the engineering, procurement, construction, and commissioning. I used to work for Larsen & Toubro, the turnkey manufacturers. So I joined at L&T Mumbai. And in the next month, I was deputed on international assignment, wherein I was working just a place called Sohar, roughly 200 kilometers from here, on the way to Muscat, where L&T had a offshore construction yard. So I started my assignments over there. If you see, there is onshore and offshore oil extraction. I used to work for the offshore oil extraction company. So I started, my first project was an oil drilling rig. As you can see, it's designed for 70 meter water depth. I was working on construction of this oil rig. Oil rigs are basically big drilling tool used to drill oil. So this was my first assignment. Actually, L&T takes projects. So, yeah.
Where is the drilling apparatus in this?
The one which you see, I don't have a laser pointer over here. It's called the derrick. If you can see over here, this is the derrick. This is the derrick. From derrick, it goes up. If you see the previous slide, yeah, if you can see, this is the drilling derrick, which goes through the platform and drills. So this is an extendable platform which comes out and does the drilling. This is called the oil rig. So if you see, this is a water depth. So currently we see only top 20 meters of the oil rig, but on ground it looks something like this. So this was my first assignment. Normally L&T takes on a turnkey basis projects. The duration of these projects is roughly 1.5 years to 2 years, and the cost of this project starts from $100 million to $1 billion as well. My second project was a loadout and transportation, basically fabrication plus transportation of offshore platforms. As you can see in the pictures, these are the offshore platforms on which the platform sits, and it was a 70 meter water depth platform which I worked on. Can you just guess what the weight of this platform was? It was 13,000 tons, which is equivalent to some 5,000 Land Cruisers or more than an entire train load. So it was huge. So shifting the jackets gets fabricated on land, and then it needs to be transported onto the ship so that it gets transported to the offshore. So the main activity which transfers the jacket from the land onto the ship was my assignment. And actually, L&T has an interesting management structure wherein L&T has all the directors, all the CEOs. Yeah.
Are these grounded or do they float? How?
Which one? Actually, these jackets are sent to the offshore onto the site, and then they are toppled, and then they are screwed. What did you say? Then they're fixed onto the sea platform. Actually, this is the horizontal one. It's toppled afterwards.
The sea platform will be tricky.
All are built on the sea, right? Many are anchored down.
Yeah, actually anchored ones are the ones which are used in high water depth. In Indian offshores, it's the all the water depths are roughly 60 to 70 meters. In such shallow water depth, the anchored ones are not feasible.
Qatar and all also they have floating rigs.
Yeah, yeah. But this was for Indian offshore.
So these are not floating, these are actually
these will be the one the structure. If you want to go into detail, this is called the buoyancy tank. So once it's floated onto the main side of the Mumbai High site, it will be filled with water as a buoyancy tank so that its weight gets increased, then it's toppled and then it's fixed onto the platform. So basically the main challenge in it is 13,000 ton weight needs to be transported onto the ship with a accuracy of hardly 10 centimeters, and this needs to be done in 15 days time. As I was going through, since L&T doesn't import any of their top leaders from outside, if you can see all the board of directors are L&T, the common term used is L&T blood. So L&T has a perfect model of succession planning and fast track training program. So when I was in Oman, I was selected through all the six rounds and I was selected for a fast track program of L&T's. So actually then I was given a choice that I can choose my areas. So I chose the project management area for this loadout transport. So that was my achievement, and I got noteworthy contribution award from the CEO for this. From my board. Then I went to Mumbai. On my third year, I went to Mumbai and I started working in procurement department. Basically, procurement is the main 40% cost of the entire project is about procurement. So I started working in Mumbai as a central procurement team. Then mainly I was responsible for global sourcing of the entire project, and as well as negotiations with the client as well, that is EIL or ONGC. If you see for the oil and gas field, the roles for marketing is mainly what we can say, brand, increasing the brand visibility of your company, plus industrial marketing. It's mainly industrial marketing, where it's techno-commercial marketing. Plus, if we see for supply chain, mainly the jobs are global sourcing, procurement, as well as logistics of this huge modules. That's it. Thank you.
Tejas, why did you select this project? I mean, you are given an option, right? Why did you select this
project? The main challenging task was this technology was never used in L&T. If you see, normally all these heavy structures are lifted and then put onto the barge. But the weight of this structure was so huge, so it was skidded out. So a special type of grease was used, and the only technology, only technical competence that we had were the videos from Malaysian loadout operation. So looking at the videos and videos and designs, we were to design the entire process. Actually, there is a loadout contractor called Mahmood Attach. So we need to coordinate with him as well. So it was a very challenging project. We were working at 48 degree temperature, 95% humidity. So physically it was challenging. The time pressure was immense. Basically, if this project is delayed by 2 days, then the cost implication at offshore is roughly a crore rupees. So the time pressure was immense, the physical challenges were huge, and no one had done it in L&T. I was the first one to do it on L&T's behalf. So that's why it was challenging, and probably that's why I got appreciated. Yeah.
I know Shlomo is also in this field, and in fact there are an entire value chain.
Yes.
Yes. The entire handover,
yes.
Including the maintenance.
Yes.
Yes. So, as L&T bearing the labor cost and other cost parameters, what is the advantage L&T has? I mean, L&T has.
Actually, L&T's major advantage till date was L&T was the only player in Indian waters. Indian government has certain rules, protective rules, in which no Chinese company or no foreign companies can enter into Indian waters unless it's necessary. So whenever an Indian player enters into the tender bidding process, Indian players always gets the preference. So till date, L&T used to get all preference, and on this start, on this aspect, L&T thrived. That was its competitive advantage till date. But now even L&T has started going abroad. L&T has taken projects for Abu Dhabi company, and basically L&T's advantage is all cost, because technologically L&T is not that advanced as you said, Norwegian players or for that matter American players as well. No, but actually, if you want to enter Indian water and do installations in Indian water, then you need to go by ONGC. But actually, time has come when now Indian companies are going abroad, because probably India has only 1% of oil reserves in the entire world. But now we see ONGC Videsh going to Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan. So now Indian companies are going abroad, and to go out there, Indian companies need to have some expertise in the field. That budding period was provided to L&T by probably ONGC and other Indian governments, which was a big plus for L&T. Naik will be the last chairman of the entire L&T. After M. Naik retires, probably next year, it will be spun off into 9 different companies. Oil and gas will be one vertical of it. Actually, even under M. Naik, we have 9 verticals, but somehow the entity is the same. But after he goes, there will be separate 9 companies from next year.
It's a holding company.
Currently it's like that, but after he goes, there will be all separate 9 companies. We can't say competing because they have got different area of expertise. They want competing.
Follow the GE model.
Yes.